as we sing Meet Me There, number 49. 49.
Good to see you this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Brother Jack Campbell's coming to lead our prayer, so let's pray together.
Father, thank you that in this time of uncertainty, we have a sure foundation. Father, thank you for salvation that you've extended to all mankind, and thank you for saving my soul from a sinner's hell. Thank you for giving me eternal life. Thank you for giving me a home in heaven one day. And Father, as we gather in this formal worship setting, I pray that your name, dear Lord Jesus, will be glorified today. Spirit of God, I pray that you would continue to move in the hearts and lives of the choir members and of these in the audience. I pray that we will worship you today, dear Lord Jesus, in spirit and in truth. Holy Spirit of God, we call upon you now to empower our pastor to preach the word of God with power. I pray for those who are lost here today. Dear Holy Spirit of God, pierce that heart and may they recognize that they need a Savior and salvation is available. Continue to bless Brother Sonny Harvey as he leads the choir and every portion of this service, whether it's through giving, testimony, preaching, or invitation, may your name be glorified, dear Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Jack. You may be seated. Choir may be seated as well. Glad you're here this morning. Thank you for coming, being a part of the service at Mount Pisgah Baptist Church. Maybe this is the first time that you're visiting with us or the first time in a long time. If that's the case, you're our special guest. We're delighted you're here. We have a gift for you along with a visitor's card and an ink pen. We'll ask that you take just a moment and fill out the visitor's card and drop it in the offering plate when we receive the offering here in just a bit. So if you're visiting for the first time or the first time in a long time, would you lift your hand way up high? Our ushers are in the back. They're making their way toward the front. Do you have any first-time visitors this morning? All right. All home folks in, I guess. No, we've got some folks right here. Brother Tom's got them, some folks in the back. Brother Ralph's got some people visiting with him. All right, good to have you folks. Thank you for being our guests today. I'll remind all of you about the green prayer request cards in the songbook rack in front of you. If you have a special request that you'd like for us to pray with you about, fill in that request form, drop it in the offering plate, and we'll take those requests and we'll read them from the pulpit toward the end of the service and have prayer just for the special needs that you write in. Once again, glad you're here today. May the Lord bless you is our prayer. Right now, the choir is going to stand and sing for us. I'll meet you in the morning.
Please turn to 178. Let's stand and sing, Jesus Loves Even Me. glad that our Father in heaven tells of his love in the book he has given. Wonderful things in the Bible I see. This is the dearest that Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me. Though I forget him and wander away, still he doth love me wherever I stray. Back to his dear loving arms would I flee, when I remember that Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me. Oh, if there's only one song I can sing, when in his beauty I see the great King, this shall my song in eternity be. Oh, what a wonder that Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me.
Aren't you glad Jesus loves you? Let's fellowship together as the choir comes down. Shake hands with those around you. That was good to see him in the house of the Lord this morning. Bless you, brother.
I'm thankful you're at Mount Pisgah this morning. Thank you so much for coming. As we've been doing it on Sundays, we've been praying for our military personnel, people that you know in the military. I've been having you to stand. If you know someone in the military, I want you to stand in the reserves military. I want you to stand in honor of that person, a member of that person. You stand where you are. And as you're standing, I want you to keep that person in mind while we pray and ask God to bless that individual. Brother Chester Brooks is going to come. He's going to pray for us, for these individuals. He's going to pray for our president and leaders of our country during this time. You know, it's been almost a month, and isn't it sad how quickly something so tragic can get off the minds of some people? Now, you can't live your life there, but I'll tell you what, we can't forget it, and we can't forget what we're engaged in. That's the devil's best trick, is to forget what we're engaged in. We cannot do that. And I'll do my best to keep us from doing so. But Chester Brooks, I'm going to pray for us. You pray with him.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, dear God, for all your blessings. Father, we thank you for these men, Father, that served in service, dear God, that they served for their country, Father, in fighting. And Lord, we pray, dear God, for the ones, Lord, that is serving today, oh God, that you'll have your hands upon them, Lord. Yes. We thank you for these men, Father. Father, we thank you, Lord, for their families, dear God, that you'll bless them. Yes. Oh, Father, we thank you for our president, dear God, that you'll bless him and guide him, Father, in these perilous days, Lord, that Father, that we may go into war very soon, dear God, that you'll protect them. Thank you for our church family. Thank you for our pastor. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. All right. Brother Keith's going to come. He's going to pray for our missionaries this morning. There's a lot of those that are suffering. Many of them are being slain in some countries where the gospel is not welcome. They're dying while we enjoy this freedom. And we want to pray for them. Brother Price, you pray for them.
Our Father in heaven, it's once again this day that we come to Thee in the precious name of Jesus. As we think about our missionaries, Lord, how I pray that you might help and minister to each one. I'm talking about Bible-believing missionaries literally around the world, not just the ones that we support, although I'm thankful for those, but I pray you'll help Bible-believing missionaries around the world. Encourage those that are discouraged. I pray that, Lord, you'll cause your face to shine upon them. Those going through difficult times and those going through trying times in their lives, how I pray that you'll just wrap your arms of love and care around them. I pray that souls would be saved as a result of their efforts. I pray Christians would be encouraged. But again, Lord, we bring our missionaries now, and missionaries throughout the world before Thee, and ask that you would help them this day. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Take the offering.
All right, men, if you'll come, we'll receive the offering this morning. Brother Lanford, you want to come up and pray for us, please?
Father, as we come to you this morning, we come with grateful hearts, thanking you for the many blessings you bestowed upon us. Thank you for this church, Father, and we thank you for each one that's come this way. We pray, God, that you would be with us in the service this morning, God, that you would bless Brother Walls as he stands to bring the message today, God, that you will bring, that he will speak the words that you have him to speak to us, God. Help us that when we leave here, we will be better Christians, God, than we were when we came. Father, we pray that you would bless our country now, bless our leaders, and we pray that you would give them the knowledge that they need, God, to go into this this crisis that we have, God. And Father, now we ask you to bless this offering, Father, this morning, and we pray that your blessings be upon it. And God, we ask you to use it for thy glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Brother Lanford. May the Lord bless us as we give this morning. Thank you, ladies. Scripture says, Matthew chapter 11, verse 29, "Take my yoke upon you, learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls." Coming to sing just before the message is Lynn and Gina Jackson, along with Rick Smith, and they're singing "Haven of Rest." My soul is safe in the haven of perfect rest. I will not sail the wide seas anymore.
A tempest may sweep o'er the waters of stormy deep, but in Jesus I'm safe. Savior, he patiently waits to save by his power divine. Come anchor your soul in the haven of rest and say, my beloved is mine.
Chapter number 2, please. The book of Acts, chapter 2. I'm going to speak to you while you're looking for that. Look this way while you're finding that. Baptists can't do two things at once. They can't even shake hands and sing at the same time. Let's look this way. I hope you can see what I have in my hand. I'm going to step to the side so Jeff can get a good picture of it on television. It's a beautiful New Testament, a flag with an eagle on the front of it. Very beautiful. This is just a rough draft. What we're going to print is going to be much more elaborate, much more brighter in color. We're sending 10,000 of these to New York City. And so I wanted to do this morning, I wanted to challenge some people, particularly who listen to us by television or by radio, that don't come, maybe have never given to this ministry before, and we can send them for $1 apiece. I mean, we can have them on New York City. That's delivered for $1 apiece. And it's a marked New Testament. Crown College will be taking them for us. We're going to print them and take them to Knoxville. Crown College will take them to New York City. And there's going to be a list of names of churches, local churches in the area, that's printed in here. So when they read it and they want to find a local church nearby in New York, they'll have a place to go. There's, I think, 20-some churches, 21 churches that area that we know that preach the gospel. It's probably more than that, probably, that we know that preach the gospel of Christ. And we're going to give those to them absolutely free. And they're all marked editions. And in other words, they show you how to get saved. You read to page one. If you want to know more to get saved, you can. That's what they're. We're going to do that. You can have us put them together if you want to at the print shop. They're going to be doing that.
I'll have the covers a week from Monday.
A week from Monday, we'll have the covers. We do need help putting the Bibles together, collating the scriptures. Brother, I came up with the idea of sending 10,000. Brother H.B. came up with the design, did an excellent job on it, and I appreciate him doing that. It's very beautiful. And when I saw it, I just said, wow. It said something. In other words, if you try to give them a tract, many of them won't take it. If you just said, here's a New Testament, they won't take it. But when they see the flag with an eagle on it, they say, I want that. How many would you like to have one? For $10, you can have it. Oh, I'm terrible, aren't I? But if you'd like to help us, $1 apiece would send one. And if you want to do that, if you want to put an offering in or give it to me after church or something, just put WTC on the envelope, World Trade Center, and we'll know what it means. That's kind of been the three little words that everybody sees they associate with it. We'll see it get there. Every penny of it will go to do that. I think it's something great. I think it's a good thing. Something we can do that'll help for eternity as well and help the hurting, give them the Word of God. All right, let's take our Bibles out of Acts chapter 2. If you're able, I would like for you to stand with me, please. If you're not, you can remain seated. Acts 2, verse number 15. For these are not drunken, as ye suppose, seeing it's but the third hour of the day. It's only 9 o'clock of the morning. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. It shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and on your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servant and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will shew wonders in the heaven above, and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, and the moon into blood, for that great and notable day of the Lord come. It shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Dear Spirit of God, help me today as I'll do my best to preach the truth of your word. Speak to every heart. Do what needs to be done. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I pray with thanksgiving. Amen. I told the church Wednesday night this little story I heard the other day. I'll tell it to you just to draw your attention to something I can. A man took one of his friends duck hunting with him one day. And he said to the man, he said, I have a very unusual dog that I want you to see him, I want you to look at the dog, and I want you to tell him what you think of this dog. It's a very unusual dog. So the man said, I'll go with you, and I'll go duck hunting with you, and we'll observe the dog, and we'll see what it's like, and said, I'll give you my opinion about it. So they went duck hunting, and they were sitting in the boat, and some ducks flew over, they shot a duck, and it fell in the water, and he called to his dog, and it jumped out of the boat, walked across the water, picked the duck up, walked back across the water, and brought it back and put it in the boat. The man didn't say anything. So the guy's sitting there, another duck flies over, he shoots, and another duck falls down, and duck gets out of the boat, walks across the water, picks the duck up, walks back across the water again, puts the duck in the boat. Guy still didn't say anything. He said, aren't you going to say anything about my dog? He said, yeah, he can't swim, can he? Some people, no matter how obvious it is, never get the point. but I want you to get the point this morning. Jesus Christ had lived his life sinless, spotless, Son of God, born of a virgin, lived his life. He had cast out devils, healed the sick, gave compassion to the hurting, touched the defiled, confirmed the religion of his day in the time of hypocrisy, raised the dead to life again, was arrested in a garden, given a mock trial, walked up a lonely hill, died a horrible death at Calvary for you and for me, was placed in a borrowed tomb because he wasn't going to eat very long. On the third morning, he arose over death the victor. He spent 40 days on this earth in his body of resurrection. He appeared to some people during that time. At the end of 40 days, he was on top of a Mount of Olives, and he went to heaven on a cloud. The disciples watched him go away. He told his disciples, "You go to an upper room, and you wait there." And they went. And 10 days later, after waiting, the Holy Spirit of God, where 120 believers had gathered together, came to comfort them, because he is the comforter that is to come. And God took up his abode in the residence of believers' hearts that day at Pentecost. When on that day, those disciples were given unusual power to speak the word of God, speak a language they'd never learned. It's called speaking in tongues, and there's nothing wrong with that phrase, but it simply means a language that they'd never learned. Matter of fact, it seems like Peter, if we read the text, Peter is the only one doing the preaching, but they're hearing in a language that they had never learned, and that God spoke through the ears of those people that were there, and 3,000 got saved that day as Peter preached to them the mighty works of God. Keith, where's Brother Price at? Turn the air conditioning down a little bit cooler, all right? And then here's what the Bible says. Look in Acts chapter 2 with me, please, if you would. Here's the mighty works that Peter declared that day. Look at verse number 22. He said, "Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as you yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determined counselor and foreknowledge of God, you've taken, and by wicked hands you've crucified and you've slain, whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it." So the mighty works that Peter preached at Pentecost was the fact that Jesus Christ died, was buried, and rose again. There's no greater truth than the death, burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ. It defeats the devil, gives us hope for heaven, and gives us hope in our situations where we are. Now, those people so moved by the Spirit of God and spoke in other languages, people around them had their opinion what was taking place. Look at verse number 12 with me. You see the opinion of some of them. They said this, "And they were all amazed." And they were in what? Some of them doubted, said, "This is just a bunch of mockery." Some saying one to another, what means this? We don't know. Others mocking, and they said, "These men are what? Full of new wine." But Peter, standing up with 11, lifted up his voice, and he said unto them, "Ye men of Judea, and all that dwell in Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words. For these are not drunken, as you suppose, seeing it's but the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel." Now, when I came to verse number 16, and I read those words that Peter said that day, he said, "This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel." A question ran through my mind. How could Peter be so dogmatic in the day he lived and tell his people who were present there that he knew what was happening in their time, he knew what was going on that very hour while they were standing there? How could he say it so dogmatically, "This is that which the prophet Joel talked about"? September the 11th. How many times have people asked this question? Is this the time for the Lord to come again? Is this the end of the world that people have talked about for ages and ages? Is this the time? Is this that time? CNN News reported that there's been an increased sale on the Bible and books on prophecy. Let me save you some money before you go out and start buying some books on prophecy. They got everything they got out of here. Save your money, buy a New Testament, and send it. If you know the author, the Holy Spirit, you've got the book, just read it. That's all you need. And if you run across some nut that tells you that on December the 15th of this year, Jesus Christ is coming again, you put him down. He's a heretic. No man knows the day of the coming of the Son of God. One thing we do know, that he is coming one of these days. But Peter gave an answer to these people. He said, this is that day. And I'm going to tell you why I could do that. And I'm going to preach this morning on, is this that day? Peter could absolutely say, when he stood there with that crowd and saw all that going on, this is that day, for two reasons, basically. Number one, because of the accuracy of Scripture. The prophet Joel had spoken under the anointing of the Spirit of God. And he had put down that there was a day coming. There would be a day like this. Now, prophecy is twofold. This is a twofold prophecy. It had to do with the present day and a day that's yet to come. For unto us, for instance, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Twofold prophecy. Birth, 33 letters, death. The government shall be upon his shoulders in that same text, separated by 2,000 years plus. So when you read prophecy, sometimes you're talking about immediately happening or things that can happen yet in the future. So here he's speaking. Joel is talking. And Joel is, when he speaks these words, and Peter knew because of the accuracy of Scriptures, he can say, this is that day. Take your Bibles and turn with me now. I want you to see this, to 2 Peter. Hey, folks, you're going to need what I'm going to tell you this morning, because someone's going to question your faith in this hour. You're going to need something to tell your children one of these days what's going on in our time and our society. Look in 2 Peter chapter number 1, please. 2 Peter chapter 1. I've got a lot to say this morning. I'm going to do my best to say it all. 2 Peter chapter 1. Peter is preaching. He says, more, the same man who preached on Pentecost is talking to us now. He said, moreover, I will endeavor that you may be able, after my decease, to have all these things always remembered. He said, when I'm gone, there's some things I want you to remember. For we have not followed cunning devised fables, when we have made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. But we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. Peter said, I saw him. I laid my hands upon him. I touched him. I felt him. I heard him, Peter said. For he received from God the Father, Jesus did, honor and glory, when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, this is my beloved Son, whom I'm well pleased. Now hang on for a second. Listen to me. Keep your hand up. Listen to me. Peter's talking about the day upon the top of Mount Transfiguration when Jesus Christ was there, Elijah was there, and Moses was there, and God spoke from heaven that day. Peter was there, and James and John was there, and he spoke from heaven. Jesus said, he heard an audible voice. God said, this is my beloved Son, whom I'm well pleased. Peter said, I was there, I heard it. I saw Jesus Christ, I saw Moses, I saw Elijah. He said, I was there. Look at verse 18. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the holy mount. Oh, but listen to this. Listen. We have also a more sure word of prophecy. He said, God's word is more sure than the vision I saw. Did you hear him? Here's why. Whereunto you do well, you take heed as unto a light that shines in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your heart. Here's the reason why. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scriptures is of any private interpretation. What God gave us in this book didn't. Verse 21. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. In other words, here's what happened. God said, Moses, you write down, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God said, you put it down. And what you and I have, we have the accuracy of Scripture this morning because of what God has told us. And from the very first promise of prophecy in the Bible, in Genesis 3:15, where God said the seed of the woman would bruise the seed of the serpent, from that very first promise God gave, to the very last promise in Revelation 22, where Jesus said, behold, I come quickly. I want to tell you everything that God has promised has come to pass and will come to pass. Not one jot. You heard this, have you not ever heard? Not one jot or tittle will pass.
Not one jot. The jot is the smallest mark in the Hebrew alphabet, which is the Old Testament. He said a tittle is the smallest marking in the Greek alphabet in the English New Testament. And God said this. He said, not one jot or tittle shall pass till all be fulfilled. How can we say this is that? Because of the accuracy of Scriptures. I don't have time to develop it this morning. Joshua was dying. Chapter 24. He said all that God promised came to pass. The writer of Kings said, all he said he'll do. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried to earthen furnace, purified seven times. Now, there's two books in this generation that people are asking about. And I don't mean to be critical. I'm just going to tell you. The Bible and the Quran. Someone asked an important question. Ask a young boy one day. Some students were sitting in a class. Teacher walked over to a young boy, preacher. It was a preacher teaching in class. Said, son, he said, do you believe the Bible to be the Word of God? He said, yes, sir. He said, I believe it is. He says, does it make it the Word of God because you believe it? He said, well, sure it does. He said, son, here's a guy over here. He's not your faith. He has the Quran. He believes the Quran is God's Word. Now, if he believes the Quran, the Word of God, is the Quran the Word of God? He said, well, yes, it is. See, when you have that philosophy of life, your faith does not make the Bible the Bible. The Bible's the Bible because the Bible's the Bible. You understand that? It's God breathed to us. That's why it's God's book to us. This is that day. And I tell you that this very hour I'm living, I say it because the accurate Scripture, this is that day of the coming of the Son of God. Wait a minute. Hang on. There's a second reason Peter can say that. Not only because of the accuracy of Scripture, because of the ability of God. You see, what God's promised, He's able to do. Did He promise He'd give us a son? Did He? Did Jesus say, I have apparently done my life, I have apparently taken it up again? Did he say that? Did He arise? What He's promised, He's able to do. Abraham said, I'm fully persuaded. What He's promised, He's able to do. Listen, the Jewish race who rejected the Messiah when He came the first time. And the Bible speaks in Romans chapter number 11 that God took us Gentiles and we were like a grafted in branch where God's stripped away the vine and God grafted us in, and we're growing in the grace of God because of the Jewish people who rejected God. God's showing favor toward us Gentiles. But the Bible says in Romans chapter 11, listen to me now. God, this is why we can speak with absolute certainty about Israel's history or about Israel's future. It's because God, listen to me now, is able to graft them in again. Listen, that's what we read, Ezekiel 38 and 39. We know what God's doing. That's what we read about. We speak with absolute certainty because we know of the ability of God. Now, take your Bibles to Matthew 24 for a second. This is that day. Matthew 24. The disciples have all come to Jesus and asked Him about the end of the time, the signs of His coming. They've asked Him those questions. And here's what He says to them in Matthew 24, verse number 4. Matthew 24, verse 24. See if this sounds like the morning newspaper to you. Matthew 24, are you there? If you found verse 4, say amen. Okay. Jesus answered and He said unto them, take heed no man deceive you. For many shall come saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled. It's another word in Luke 21. It says, be not terrified. Don't let the terrorists terrify. Take the terror out of terrorists. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation. We see sides being taken. And kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilence and earthquakes. Pestilence? Earthquakes? diverse places. These are the beginning of sorrows. Listen to me quickly. Now listen. When you read about signs in the Bible of the end time, every one of them point to what we call the revelation of Christ, when he's going to come back and every eye shall see him. But there's an event going to happen 7 years before that called the rapture, where every saved person is going to leave this world. That's one you better be interested in. So if we see the signs that are pointing toward this being shadowed now, because we see the shadow of them now, we know the substance not far down the road. Can you see some shadows? September the 11th, World Trade Center, Pentagon, Pittsburgh. Violence in Israel. Never intensified like this in times of peace like it is now, with two or three nations around them, warring them. I did not know this till the other night. I was listening to the radio. I tell you, I did not know this. And I'm sorry, and I feel like a miserable Christian because I did not know this. There have been 2 million Christians killed in the last 6 years for their faith. Christians. The downing of the Russian airplane. The Greyhound bus attack in Manchester, Tennessee. Perilous times. People start copycatting. After they see, they start copycatting. Don't they? Amtrak's case in Florida. First time in 25 years, infection in the lungs of the disease. I'm not trying to frighten you. I'm saying lift up your heads. Redemption draweth nigh. This is that. This is that day of salvation. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is that. Listen to what Exodus 12:42 says when he talked about coming out of Egypt bondage. Remember when they put the blood on the doorpost? Remember that? Listen to what it says. Don't turn. Listen to what it says. He says, "It is a night to be much observed. It is unto the Lord for bringing them out of the land of Egypt. This is that night of the Lord's redemption." This is the night. Neither is there, listen to me, now is the accepted time, today is the day of salvation. If you said to me, "Pastor, I need to get saved, and I want to get saved, and quick as you're done preaching, I'll get saved," I'd tell you, you get saved right now. You call upon the Lord right now. And where you're sitting, you ask him right now. We may not be here by the time we get through preaching. And I plan on stopping before noon too. I'm just telling you, folks, now's the time. Second thing, this is that time of salvation. Listen, Jesus Christ, this is that one who's able to save. Listen to what he said about him in John 6:58. "This is that bread which came down from heaven. He is the bread of life for dying sinners." You know, you think I'm picking on somebody when I am, and I'm not trying to. But I'll tell you what, the truth's what sets you free. And if you don't know the truth of where we're standing, folks, you've got some bad problems to deal with. Here's a good question to ask those. This could be divisive. Don't mean for it to be, but it's the truth. Muslims believe that Muhammad's a prophet. They can go visit his dead carcass over there in their land. They don't have a risen Savior. Sorry. By the way, I've got a man coming here. I've got some days planned because I feel like our church need to hear about this. I've got a man coming here who deals with these folks and have ministered to him for years. He's going to be here on a Sunday. Of course, in just a few weeks. I talked to him on the phone last night. Tremendous man. We've known him for years. Now, the Muslims say that Jesus Christ is a prophet. Okay? They say that Muhammad's a prophet. They say that Jesus Christ is a prophet. You got it? The next thing they say is no prophet can lie. They say Muhammad cannot lie. They say that Jesus Christ cannot lie. You got that? Here's the question. I have had an opportunity to ask a couple of them this a couple of times, which I never got an answer for. You say that Muhammad's a prophet. You say Jesus Christ is a prophet. You say that a prophet cannot lie. Jesus said this. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Was he lying or is he? This is that way of salvation. Now, I don't know what you think about some preachers that I heard on the television here recently. But I heard one of them say something the other day that I don't know that much about him. I don't know much about him. And I'm not here to stand up for him, or I'm not saying anything against him. But Franklin Graham said the other day, he said that Jesus Christ is the only way to heaven. He said that publicly. He said, and there's no other way besides Jesus Christ. He said on television. They kept wanting to shut him up, but he kept saying it. And I thank God he had the grace to say it and the courage to say it. Amen? Thank God for what he did. And whether you agree with everything he does, everything else, it doesn't matter, except the message is true. Amen? Now, if you believe that this is the day, if it is your conviction in your heart, you believe this is the day, there's several things the Bible says if you believe it, the Bible says it'll be evident in your life if you believe it. Several things. I'm going to give them to you, and I'm done. Number one, you'll make sure you're saved. Yeah. I'm not going to have you to turn there. It'll take you too long. If you want the scriptures afterwards, I'll give them to you. It's going to take me a while to find them, but you listen to this one. He's coming in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God, that have not obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ. If there's one thing that you better make sure of this very hour that you live, you better make sure you're saved. I mean, that you know Christ. I didn't say you're a church member. I didn't say you're a tither or a giver. You better make dead sure that you're saved. The second thing that you'll do if you believe this is the day, you'll quit judging other believers. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse number 5 says, judge nothing before the time when Jesus Christ comes. He'll bring all things into judgment. You'll quit judging other people, other believers. You don't have no business doing that. You ain't got time to do that. If you keep your nose in your own business, you haven't got enough time to take care of that. Amen? There's something else you'll do. If you believe Jesus Christ, listen, I'm just going to give them to you. If you believe Jesus, if you believe this is that day, your prayer life's going to be affected. 1 Thessalonians 3:12-13 talks about him coming again and us being involved in fervent prayer. Hey, listen to me. If I as a pastor believe Jesus Christ is coming again, I'll take the admonition that Paul gave to young Timothy. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. He said, because Jesus Christ is coming again. I'm recommitted to the ministry. I'm recommitted to tell you the truth whether you want to hear it or not. Look at Hebrews 10:25 with me for a second. Hebrews 10:25. There's something else. If you believe that Jesus Christ is coming again, if you believe this is that hour, look what it says in Hebrews 10:25. Not forsaking the assembling yourselves together as the matter of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much how? The more as you see the day approaching. God said you'll be more faithful. Now, I'm asking you a question. Is that what God said? If you believe this is that day, then you'll be more faithful. Your actions will prove what you believe. James 5:8 says you'll be more steadfast because the judge stands at the door. This isn't the time we quit. This isn't the time we faint. This is the time we keep on going. Listen to this verse of Scripture. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. It does not yet appear what we shall be. We know when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him of seeing him will purify himself even as he's pure. If you believe this is the day, you're going to live a pure life for God. You're going to watch what you do, watch what you say, watch where you go. Because wouldn't you hate for God to catch you some places? Watching some things? Having the wrong internet program pulled up? This is that day. Here's nothing you're going to do. Look unto Jesus. The Bible talks about it. We're going to look to him in Titus chapter 2. Be zealous of good works because he's coming again. You're not going to sit back. You know, the idea of Jesus Christ coming is not you get in a rocking chair and you wait. It's you occupy till he comes. There's some folks out in Arkansas years ago, they kept saying Jesus Christ would come. They sold everything they want, went to a mountaintop to wait on him. They starved to death if they stayed there long enough. We don't do that. We work till he comes. You get involved with some of these church programs right here. The Awana program is going to start. You that volunteered, you need to get in work with that because our Christ is coming. There's something else you ought to be. And if you'll turn to Luke 21 with me, I'll give you this last thing. If you believe this is that day, your heart ought to be comforted. You know why? Because Jesus said, and the fact he was coming again, comfort one another with these words. Is that what he said? He sure did. Can I tell you something? It makes you think less of me. You can think less of me. I'll wrestle with something in my life when the hours get quiet at night. I'll wrestle with the fact of dying. I'd almost like the devil say, "You're going to die." And I wrestle with it sometimes. My wife's down in Virginia Church this morning. Last night I got in the middle of the night, right before I went to sleep, and she saw I wasn't acting normal just by doing what I usually do. She said, "What's wrong?" And I said, "Nothing. I wouldn't want her to know what's bothering me." And she will now, because you'll tell her. And I was just wrestling with it. I mean, you know, I'm going somewhere I've never been. You understand? I'm talking about something happened to me I've never ventured before. So I just got up, went to a quiet place in the house, and I said, "Devil, I'm going to heaven. I know I'm saved, and you can bug me all you want to, but I said, thank God, I know where I'm going." And I said, "I'm going to sleep, and you can worry about it." And I did. But I wrestled that just periodically. You say, well, and I'd say you do. If you'd be honest with me, you probably do too. I want you to listen to what Jesus said. And I prepared a message on this. I'll preach it here in a couple of weeks. I want you to listen to what Jesus said. He's talking about the same thing in Luke 21. I want you to listen to what he said. Look at verse number 8 with me. And he said, "Take heed that you be not deceived. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and the times draw near. Go you not therefore after them. But when you hear of wars and commotions," tell me that word. Don't be terrified. Don't let the terrorist cause you terror. Is that what he said? Here's what he told you to do. Look in chapter 21, verse number 34. One verse, one story, and I'm through. "And take heed to yourself, lest by any time your hearts be overcharged or superfluing." Don't get involved. Listen to me. Here's what he's telling you about his coming. He said, don't get involved in things that don't matter. And with drunkenness, live a sober life. And the cares of this life, don't let them bother you, he says, so that you come not, that day comes not upon you unawares. He said, don't let the things of this life bother you and trouble you. But seek you first the kingdom of God, is what Matthew 6 talks about. Have an article in front of me. I brought the article so I would not misquote anyone. I want to read it and I'll give an invitation. Have you ever heard of the guy they call Brian Gumbel? He recently interviewed Billy Graham's daughter. Here's the question he asked. It's a question you've heard 1,000 times. He said, going to embarrass her, make her feel bad. You know how they try to do people, especially if you're a Christian. They'll say this, why didn't God stop this? Talk about September the 11th. Why didn't God stop this or do something about this? That's what he asked her. National television. Everybody's listening. Here's what she answered. For years, we've told God we didn't want him in our schools. We didn't want him in our government. And we didn't want him in our finances. And God was being a perfect gentleman in doing just what we'd ask him to do. God has been a gentleman. I'm not going to barge my way in. And she said, we need to make up our minds, do what God wants us to do, or do we want God or do we not want him? Or do we just want him in times of disaster? Ahab and Elijah met one day, and Elijah said to Ahab, how long will you halt between two opinions? He said, if God's God, let's serve him. And if Baal's God, let's serve Baal. But let's do one or the other. And it's time that we made up our minds, folks. If God's God, he's God in the good times, he's God in the bad times. And if you want to serve something else, go serve him. If you're going to serve God, let's get on with it. Amen? That's the story. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. This is that day. You know, these days sometimes calls for drastic measures. You know that? Anyone who's saved by the grace of God should never be ashamed of it, should they? I want to ask you to do me a favor. I want you to keep your head bowed. I want you to keep your eyes closed. I don't want you looking to your right. I don't want you looking to your left. You're the person I'm talking to, and no one else. Did you understand that? How many quickly would raise a hand and say, Pastor, I know I'm saved. And if Jesus were to come, I know I'd go home to be with him. Would you raise your hand up high just for a second? God bless you. I'm glad you know that. Did anyone this morning be honest enough to say, Pastor, there was a time in my life I made a profession of faith, but I'm not really sure, honestly, if I would have died to go to heaven? Or you would say, Pastor, I've never been saved. Would you just raise your hand and say, Pastor, would you just pray for me this morning? I'm not going to come and talk with you. I'm not going to embarrass you. I promise you. I won't call your name. Won't catch you after services. Pastor, I made a profession of faith sometime back, but I'm just really not sure if I'd die to go to heaven, or I am not sure I'd go to heaven. Would you raise your hand where I could see it? You put it up and right back down. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you for your honesty. Someone else, Pastor, I'm just not sure. I'm not sure. Would you pray for me? Would you pray for me? Now, Father, you've seen this hand that was raised. You know this heart. And this is that day. You've said you'll turn none away that they could come to know Christ in a special way, and in your powerful touch, draw this person that was honest enough to raise their hand with cords of love. And those that should have but did not, would you please work in their hearts and life this hour? I don't want to see any of them perish without you. And if you were to come today, it'd be too late for them unless they get saved. So I pray they'd come to Christ. While I'm talking and before they start playing, are there some Christians this morning that would be willing to just get up out of your seat, come somewhere and kneel here, and just say, God, in these closing days, help my life to count all for you. In these closing days, help my life to count all for you. If you do that, you slip out of your seat. You come. God, in these closing days, if I were not given the invitation, I'd be here. In these closing days, Father, I want my life to count for you. The best of my ability, I want my life to count for you. I believe that'd be the truth of all of us, but maybe God's not spoken to your heart. Dealt with that in that way. In these closing days, And while these folks are coming, how many would be willing to just slip out of your seat? You know somebody that's lost. You know someone before these days come to an end. You want to know, you want them to trust Jesus Christ. I want you to find your way near the front as you can, and I want you to pray for that individual today and ask God in mercy to deal with their heart. You come and you ask God for that person today. Would you do that, please, while we wait just a few minutes? Just a few minutes. We're not going to take long. You can find a place to sit here across the front or kneel. You can do that. Let's just ask God in His mercy and grace to reach that person's heart and deal with it and speak to them. You take time and do that just for a few minutes. It's a husband, or it could be a wife, or a child, or a mother, or a father, or a neighbor, a loved one. Oh, God, and I know who some of you are coming for, and I'm praying for them too, asking God to deal with their hearts and speak to them. Now, I've talked to some people right now that you've been saved, but you've never made it public at a church service. Could I get you this morning, in the quietness of these few minutes, I'm talking just to you now, not talking to anybody else, just you. Would you come and would you stand with me here and let me share with people? If you wish to say something to, about you, can. But if you, let me just tell the folks, you're making public what Christ did for you. You got saved at your home. You got saved someplace else. You'll not be asked to say anything unless you want to say something. But you'll come and you'll stand with me this morning. There's no use to halt between two opinions. If it's right, let's do it. You'll come and you'll stand with me this morning and say, Pastor, I've been saved. I need to make public what Christ has done for me. You come. You come on this morning while we wait just a moment. You come on while we're waiting. I'm talking to those in this room. You've been saved, but you've never gotten baptized. Maybe you want to set a time this morning to get baptized. Or maybe you want to get baptized this morning, but you need to do it. It's something you need to do. Listen, let's don't halt between the two opinions. The opinion is right. Let's do that. If you've been saved, but you've never made it public, or you've never been baptized, you need to set a time to get baptized in deep water, I want you to slip out of your seat. I want you to come right now. You come on. You come on right now. Let's take care of that. Let's get that set. I know there's several folks in this room. Either you or your children or someone need to do that. They're going to play for us the song we've chosen to sing this morning. They're just going to play for it. And I'm going to give one more thing about invitation. We're going to have a prayer. But you need to come. Listen, you've been saved. But you never followed the Lord in believers' baptism. You could have got saved at a church service here. You could have got saved somewhere else. But you've never done that. You need to do that. It's important to obeying the next step that God wants you to obey. Would you come? Would you stand with me here this morning? Would you come and stand with me this morning? I'm going to ask you one more time because I know there's someone who needs to do that. Would you come and stand with me this morning? If you need to trust Christ this morning, would you come? Would you come with me here? Let me take the word of God so you can be saved. How you can know? Would you come and do that? Sir, would you do that this morning? Ma'am, would you do that? Young person, would you do that? Several people in this room this morning, I can't make you do it, and I'm not trying to. I'm just trying to present the truth to you. You can do what the truth what you wish to. Then there are those here this morning. You'll be a part of this church. You've prayed about it. You know that's God's will for you. You've just not done it yet. Could I get you to come and stand with us this morning? Say, Pastor, I need to take care of that. Would you do that, please? You come on. We're going to stand and sing. Page what? 22. Page 22. We'll sing one verse. We'll sing one verse. You come.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
You come on while we're waiting.
Are you fully trusting
you come on.
In His grace?
Come on. Come on.
In the blood, in the soul, cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
All right, if you'll give us about 4 or 5 minutes, we'll be out of here. You can be seated, please, if you would.
A few weeks ago, I asked for some volunteers to work with our WANA program. Around 16 people raised their hands for that to take care of working in that program. All of you that volunteered, or if any others want to volunteer to work in that program, there's some information about it in the bulletin. You can read it. But there's the meetings for training are Tuesday and Wednesday night, 6:30 till 9 o'clock, I believe it is. And so you'll want to come. The nurse will be provided for you, and there'll be some refreshments here. One other thing this morning I need to mention. A few weeks ago, I asked for some individuals who would be willing to visit on their way to church on Wednesday nights. You'll stop at
didn't write it, folks. I'm just a delivery boy. You don't get mad at the paper boy when he delivers your paper. It's got bad news, do you? So I'm just the paper boy. I've dropped the mail off over at your front house door. You can read it. You can accept it. Question number two. Is Bill Clinton America's problem? When you're a leader, it's easy to take all the criticism. I can't tell you how many times I've read the Bible through. But it's interesting to note in Israel's history, now listen to me, they had kings who allowed homosexualities to live in their land, and they had times when they just killed them. Both of them is recorded for us in the history of Israel. We have the privilege of looking into that. It's revealed for us. Now, I want you to listen closely. Every time when a king permitted in his reign children to be killed passing through the fire to Moloch, what they used to do instead of abortions, they let the child be born, and they take that child while it was born and let it go pass it through a fire to offer it to it through their god. Well, isn't that horrible? There's a much simpler way. It's called abortion. This will make you sick if you haven't heard this. There's a new abortion. I told him on Wednesday night about it. It's called DNX. What they do to make sure a child is dead, instead of helping that little girl where her arm was pulled off and then she was born, and that doctor is putting gel over it. Isn't that something? If she'd have died in the womb, he'd have been all right, but since she lived, now he's in prison. They got a new procedure. They pull all the baby's body out except the head. And when they get the head turned out, they turn the baby with this bottom up toward the sky, and they take a sharp instrument like a scissor, go in the back of the baby's head right here, skull, and go in and push it through, and then they take it and open it up wider and take a suction and suck that baby's brain out, so it'll be sure to be dead when they finish pulling it out of the womb. And isn't it wonderful we get to pay for all of that? And on July the 15th, the Freedom of Choice Act, if it's passed by our congressmen and by our people that we have elected to office, we'll get continue to do wonderful things like that with our money. In the time when kings lived, some of them allowed it, some of them didn't. Now I want you to listen closely. Every case in the Bible that I know, and if I'm wrong, you prove me wrong. I'd be glad to talk with you after services. Every time when they allowed the sodomites in the land, every time when they allowed them, God cut the nation short. Let me give you some references. I don't have time this morning. I've got six more pages of notes, and I'm on about two-thirds of the way through. 1 Kings 14, 22-26. When they allowed sodomites, God sent the enemy from Egypt and destroyed them and worked on them. Now, in the Bible, when they had kings that put them down and would not let them rule and be in authority, every time God sent revival, and God blessed that nation. 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 7, the only place of lesbians mentioned in the Old Testament is mentioned there when women with their wovelings and the lesbian or the sodomites put out of the land. And it's the word there. But every time that they were put in, and they were not put in authority or put down, there was strength and there was revival to a nation. Now, wait a minute. Someone say, preacher, how can you say then? You just got through saying a while ago they have rights. And then you said, preacher, that you don't think they ought to have a right, and I've preached this before, for them to serve in our military. Sounds like a contradiction, doesn't it? Let me tell you why. I'm not against them serving in the military because they don't have a right as American citizens. I'm against them serving in the military because of the defense of our nation. Well, pastor, yeah, let me tell you why. Because blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Righteousness exalts a nation. sin is a reproach to any people. Listen closely. Bill Clinton and I don't know if anything we agree on. I don't. I'm honest. I don't. I take it back. Yeah. He bombed Baghdad. I was for that. I wished he'd do it daily. It's strange how those, how the homosexuals are against a strong national defense too, against capital punishment, for abortion. Listen to me. I pray for him every day of my life. God help President Clinton. Help Al Gore Jr. Our policemen, officers here in our town, I pray for them, Matthews and Loy and Sasser and all those people, McWhirter, every day of my life, I pray God and ask God to help them and bless them. Listen to this. Though Bill Clinton and I do not agree, listen. Bill Clinton is not America's problem, and neither is Hillary the answer. I saw a bumper sticker the other day that said I didn't vote for him or her. But you know what a strong president does to a nation that has some character and backbone and righteousness? He puts us to shame about our sinfulness. And by the way, in case you think I'm prejudiced toward that, I didn't like it when Ronald Reagan drank his booze. Okay? All right, let me be a little fair, all right? I didn't like that either. Wait, what do you think of Christian? You want to think of president or do you think you ought to be a Christian? I think you ought to do what the book of Deuteronomy says, set a book of the law beside of him, read it, and write him one. Judges 18:7 is this little verse that says, because the people were not put to shame, they become an easy prey to their enemy. If we don't have any strong spiritual standards or convictions, we'll be an easy prey to an enemy that comes in upon us. Now then, let me just say this to you. Why, there's so much to say. I'm trying to get done. Just give me a little extra few minutes this morning. Oh, but their civil rights are being violated. Civil rights usually have to do with minorities educationally or minorities in the means of finances. Did you know the top educated people of the land are homosexuals? Our article in Family Focus just recently. Did you know that the top 53% of people that make money in America are homosexuals? The top 53%. Well, they say to me, well, pastor, our preacher, our reverend, we just love each other and we just can't help it. Well, that's why the Bible gives you an answer. In 1 Corinthians 7:2, if a man wants to not commit fornication, let every man have his own wife. That'll take care of the problem. Get you a wife. You won't do nothing. Better have a little humor. It's getting awful quiet in here. That'll cut your joy out. I said a couple said, I'm marrying them. I said, are you happy or are you married? And, well, you talk about some answers I get. Let me tell you two reasons why I feel like America will fall. I'm not being pessimistic. Jeremiah was put in prison because he preached a message like this. If we fall, here's the two reasons. And I'm saying this because it's other nations in the Bible. Number one is the nations that fell always forgot God. It's not in the sense that they forgot God, it's the sense they got other gods. If you read 1 Kings chapter 13, verses 33 through 44, you'll find that they went after a strange god, and God brought them down. They went after other gods, false priests and gods, and going after them. America's problem is we got too many gods. We half-heartedly serve the Lord when we serve him. You know, and we let God in every once in a while when we have time. We'll pray and fast every once in a while. I was just reading two comparison stories in the Bible. One was when Jeremiah preached and said, you're going to fall. And they said, Jeremiah, we're going to put you in prison. And that nation fell because they didn't heed God. But one was when a prophet came to Hezekiah and said, you're going to fall. Hezekiah repented and God spared him. Why will we fall? Because we got other gods. This is a tremendous crowd on a Sunday morning, July the 4th, Labor Day, or Independence Day weekend. Tremendous crowd. And I believe that most of you people love God. And you're here, and you're going through this service with us this morning. But I want to tell you, we need some people on Mondays and Tuesdays and Wednesdays and Thursdays and Fridays and Saturdays that'll still love God and serve Him, be a witness where they are. There's another reason if America falls, it'll fall. It's recorded in 2 Chronicles 36, verses 15 through 21. Let me tell you what it says. We don't have time to look there, but I'll give you the scripture. 2 Chronicles 36, 15, 21. You know why God set the nation of Israel going to captivity? It's because they forsook God's day. They forsook God's day. God said, you're going to serve 70 years of captivity because there were 70 years you didn't observe the Sabbath day to keep it. God's day means nothing anymore. You say, well, if we can't do it during the week, we can always do it on Sunday. God didn't excuse Israel. He's not going to excuse America. God didn't let them get by with it. God's not going to let us get by with it at all. You got to turn to one more passage of Scripture with me. I'm just about through. Matthew chapter 11. Jesus gave one of the most sternest warnings in the Bible. Matthew 11, 23, and thou Capernaum, which art exalted to heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Sodom, it would remain until this day. But I say unto you that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for thee. God said, Capernaum heard the gospel, they didn't repent. And because they heard the gospel and didn't repent, God said the judgment of God was going to be harder on them than is the people of Sodom in the day of judgment. Did you hear that? And for you to sit here this morning and know you are to be saved, and you live in East Tennessee where the gospel is preached and preached and preached, and everybody that dies lost is going to go to the same hell of those, no matter how they live, what lifestyle they live, that die lost without God is going to go to the same hell. There's going to be punishment and destruction. God said, though, for the city of Sodom, in this controversial message, let me give you something else controversial. I believe there's going to be a degree of punishment in hell. For those that have never heard but die without Christ, for those that have heard but have rejected Him. Someone has said in the 1960s, America lost its respect for authority. In 1970, she lost her innocence. In 1980, with suicides increasing at 1 every 15 minutes among teenagers, 1 every 15 minutes, people of the world, America has lost its hope. And I don't want to close the message without telling you three things you can do if you want to help America. Three things you can do if you want to help America. Number one, you can get saved. Because righteousness exalts a nation. Listen to me just quickly. I was reading a couple of stories last week about the Titanic. April the 14th, 1912, sank. And over at White Star, the office where people had left from, what they were doing when they had two boards out front, they said traffic was so heavy in England, they had to suspend people from traveling. And they had two big boards out front, and people were gathered. And they had one over here, this board said, known to be saved. And over here was a sign, known to be lost. And the man who would go over to the White Store office, he would come out carrying a great big old cardboard. And on that cardboard, he'd have a name written every time he'd leave that office. And he'd stand up over that crowd of people and hold that name of that individual who'd been riding on that Titanic. And then he'd turn to that board, and either he'd place on that board, known to be lost or known to be saved. And all that mattered to those people when they came out with that name is whether they were saved or whether they were lost. That's the physical sense. And I want to tell you, we're going to leave this world one of these days, ladies and gentlemen. Or this world may come to an end, or Jesus may come. And I want to tell you, the only thing that matters was you known to be saved or were you known to be lost? That's all that matters. What can I do? I can be saved. Second thing I can do as a Christian, I can be salt. The Bible says that Christians are salt. We preserve. We get involved. We let our voices be heard. We stand up. We do what's right. Let me tell you something. God, when he looked at Sodom and Gomorrah, and when Abraham was praying over the city for God not to destroy it, he said, "Oh God, if I could find 50 righteous, would you spare this city?" God said, "I'll spare it." He got down to 10. He said, "Oh God, if I could find 10 righteous people in Sodom, would you spare the city?" God said, "I'll spare it." I don't know what America's number is, but if it's 10, if it's 20, if it's 200, if it's 1,000, I'll be part of the number that solves the problem instead of it's a problem. You can be salt. Here's the last thing you can do. You can pray. You look in the book of 2 Kings and 1 Kings, you'll find people praying for their nation and for their country. You'll see Solomon, we dedicated the temple, "Lord, if something's wrong in our land and we turn to heaven and we pray, will you heal our land? Will you forgive us?" He says it over about 7, 8, 9, or 10 times. "Father, if we don't get rain for our crops and we turn to you, will you forgive us and would you heal our land? Father, if there's some pestilence in the land and it's bothering us and killing our people, we turn and pray. Would you forgive us? Would you?" And God said, "Yes, I'll do that." And the conclusion that Solomon came to is this: "If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I'll hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sins, I'll heal their land." That's what God said. There's an interesting prayer in the book of Joel chapter 2 which says, "Let the women and the children and the men cry between the porch and the altar, Oh God, spare thy people. Oh God, spare thy people." Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed for a few minutes. You've been more than gracious to listen. Would you please give me just about 5 or 6 more minutes before you have to leave? Please do that. America needs you. Have me quickly across this room and raise a hand and say, "Pastor, I'm grateful that I'm saved. I'm grateful that Christ lives in my heart." Would you raise your hand for a word of testimony? You know Christ lives in your heart. I'm glad you can say that. America needs you to be salt if you're saved. You know that. Maybe you've not been living salt. Maybe you've forgotten God's day for the most part, or if you've gotten God in your heart and your life. If God hadn't blessed America at Pearl Harbor, if God had helped us through the wars, ladies and gentlemen, in the act of God of turning this nation, we would have been destroyed. We would have been other some third world country this morning, but God blessed America. Is it asking too much for us to live right? For us to enjoy it and pass this heritage on to our children? I'm telling you, as Christians, you can be salt. You can be salt. If you need to get things right with the Lord, won't you slip out of your seat? Won't you come and say, "Lord, help me to live for you. Help me to serve you." Some people ought to slip out this morning. If all of us ought not to come, every one of us probably ought to come and say, "Lord, just bless America." We ought to be here praying, "God, help our country." This is one day that comes on this Sunday. This one day does every 6 or 7 years. And what a day today we have. You ought to just come and say, "God, bless America. God, help our country. God, bless our leaders." We ought to be here doing that. I'm going to ask some of you to do that in a minute. I'm going to talk to you across the room here that's lost. There's people in this room, you don't know the Lord Jesus. You're not saved. You stood up in conflict, you stood up in battle, you're a man, and you should have no reason that you are to turn Christ down. You, just because there's a crowd of people here, you shouldn't be ashamed of coming to him. And I want to encourage you this morning, if you're here and you're not sure you're saved, I want to encourage you to come to Christ this morning. You need to be saved. Father, speak to every heart, I pray in Jesus' name. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, no one's looking around. I want some of our people to slip out. Anyone wants to come, I want you to come, and would you pray for our country this morning? Would you do that with me for a few minutes? Would you come and do that while others are coming to pray? And then listen, if you're here and you just need to pray about something in your own heart and life, I want you to come. Or if you're here and you need to be saved this morning, I want you to come. While they play for us on the instruments, while they're playing for us, you slip out of your seat. You come on while we're waiting. While we're waiting just a moment. While we're waiting just a moment, you slip out of your seat and you come on while we're waiting. While we're waiting just a moment, you come on. You come on while we're waiting just a moment. Thank God for America. Thank God for America. Waiting, you come on. I'm not going to tarry long this morning. I preach to you what's on my heart. If you need to be saved this morning, if I were you, I'd come. I'd come and trust Christ. He wants to save you. He can save you. He would save you if you'd come to him. Listen closely now. I want you to join with me with something just a moment. I think you've got to agree with me, whether you agree with anything else I said this morning. This country we live in needs prayers. Need the help of God. If God didn't help us, folks, we're gone. We're totally gone. We don't go to put God first. Something terrible is going to happen to us. Our children are not going to have the freedom. We enjoyed what we've enjoyed. It's a call for you and I to stand up and be men again. It's a call for you and I, ladies, to be ladies again, and young people to be young people again. It's a call. It's a call from God. Our country needs. The call has gone out before, and men have answered and responded and volunteered and said, I'll be that person. You say, I'm only one. But only one, and only one, and only one just keeps adding up. You can count for God. You can make this country count for God. I want you to join me. So one more time, we ask God to bless this country of ours. Father, help our country. Help our leaders, both at home and abroad. Help us as Christians learn to pray for them earnestly. Pray for our peace of this nation. Lord, terrorism on every hand faces us. We're going to face more than we've ever faced before. We're going to need your help. If we're going to leave to our kids anything, we're going to have to stand for God, whether it's popular or unpopular. Help us to do so in faith and with steadfastness. Give us a backbone to stand. Like others who've given themselves, we'd stand as patriots to give ourselves for that which is right. And we'll do our best to thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed now, just for a moment. If you've been saved, but you've never made public at a church service that you've been saved, maybe you've been saved in the hospital, your home, in the pastor's office, on the street, on the job somewhere, but you've been saved but never made it public, I want to encourage you this morning to make public what Christ has done for you. If this morning you're going to get baptized, I want you to come and let's get ready to baptize right now. If you do that, please, you come on. Then if you're here and this is the church, you'll be a part of this church family, I want you to come and do that this morning. So several families here are to do that. We're waiting on your decision. Why don't you do that? Let's stand together. Let's sing a verse of song, Brother Harvey. Let's stand. Let's sing. Just for a moment, please be seated. Just for a moment, we have one person we're going to baptize. Go ahead and sit down. I had a person I led to the Lord over the phone the other day. I led a lot of people to the Lord over the phone, believe it or not, and never see them. But this one I got to see, and he's going to get baptized this morning, so that's going to be a good blessing. We have Kizzy Teasley that's come this morning, and Miss Teasley wants to unite with our church family. What's the privilege of our church concerning Miss Teasley? All right, all in favor, just say aye.
Aye.
We're grateful to have you. Kizzy, hope I can be a good pastor to you. Don't leave. I want to take time to shake your hands. Brother Harvey's going to come take prayer requests. I'll get ready to baptize. It'll take me just a moment to do that. Brother Adams and the deaf choir is going to be back tonight. They'll have the whole service tonight starting at 7 o'clock. You want to come, it'll be a blessing to you. Brother Harvey, take some prayer requests. Remember, mention to him, Linda, about your daughter if he doesn't say that.
John
Davis in Oak Ridge Hospital. Is John still there?
Charles.
Got to Charles, okay. Got to come home. Otis Edwards, James Edge in the Oak Ridge Hospital. Edna Campbell is in the Patricia Neal Hospital in Knoxville. Remember her? And Maddie Glass was in the hospital, but she's not here today, though. She's at home. Okay, we've been praying for her. Vivian Hale is still in the Park West Hospital. We want you to remember her especially in prayer. Are there any others that we have not mentioned? Yes. Okay, the Robbins family, their son Tony, remember that request. Yes. Okay, pray for Melissa having surgery Thursday. Okay, Jean, unspoken request, and Debbie is at home, so that's great. Any other request? Okay, yes, John. Okay, remember his brother Carl. All right, let's remember these requests. We're going to bow our heads, please, at this time. Yes, one. Okay, Sherlyn Kofer is in the Oak Ridge Hospital. Okay, we're going to ask Brother Ken Cannon if he would remember these requests. Let's bow for prayer at this time, Brother Ken.
To baptize a celebrity. This is Danny Thomas. Yeah, just about a little bit. Danny got saved a few weeks ago. All the telephone came, made it public, and now he's following the Lord in believers' baptism. I'm grateful for that. Amen. Danny, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son, Holy Spirit. Married with Christ in baptism, risen to walk in newness of life. Bless you, buddy. God bless you. If you give me a song, Brother Harvey, I'll be out.
Superman. Forgot my cape. Oh, don't forget something else one of these days. I come right out there. Amen. Oh, that would be real funny, yeah. Let's stand to our feet. We're going. You come by. Miss Teasley's been sick for some time now, and she's going to have a hard time maybe standing here, but several of you come by and shake hands with her and just welcome to our church family this morning. Please do that for us. Hey, ushers. Hey, Terry. Is the offering plates back there at the back? Are the offering plates back there? The Deaf Choir is a church we support as a ministry. I know that you don't have to give one penny, but on your way out, if you'd just like to put something in the offering plate, you can. You don't have to. Don't feel obligated to. If you want to, just put something in the offering plate. We're going to give them more than what you give them this morning. But we just like to give them a little bit, all right? And they have a lot of expenses from coming here. So if you'd do that, it would be good for us.
Father, we are grateful for thee, for all the blessings of life, for this day that you've given to us, for these our church family and loved ones and friends who have assembled here today. We thank you for the preached word. We thank you for the songs that's been sung, for this one that was baptized and this one that has come back to our church, Lord, with such joy to have both of them in our fellowship. We ask you will go with us today, make all the things that we do count for thee. Help us to honor you in all that we do. Bless our visitors, the singers, and those that will be with us again tonight, that you will honor their efforts for Christ's sake. All of these things we ask in thy Son and our Savior's name, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.